Hi there, Connie here. I'm here to talk to you about Outlook and why you don't need Outlook for email and communication as much as you think anymore. So let's talk about your email habits first of all. Do you keep things in your email for the right reasons? And how are you going about storing that information in your email? We're going to go all the way back to when email was first introduced. And actually with Outlook, that goes all the way back to the early 1990s. 1996 being when it was introduced, but let's look at what it was intended for. So email and Outlook is intended to be a form of communication, not a form of storage. I'm gonna get back to that in a few minutes here. So why do people email you? Why do you have all this mail? Well, sometimes it's just to remind you of stuff that they want you to possibly do for them or that you need to do or promise to do. Other times, maybe it's just some notes they're sharing with you. Maybe it's a document. They want you to file it away. And sometimes it's something that you don't even need, so you should just throw it out. There is some garbage out there sometimes that we're receiving for email. So let's talk about Outlook. Let's talk about email. And let's compare it to technology that has passed us by and is a bit older. Right? So as technology improves, we see some technology just completely going out and we don't use it anymore. And other pieces of technology, well, maybe they stay around a little bit, like the fax machine here. I still know people or companies, customers of mine that actually still have fax machines. My fax machine is in my storage room. I don't use it very often, and that's why it's not plugged in. But if I need it, it's there. So it is still a form of communication, but definitely not the one that's being used the most. Email's kind of taken over in that realm of things. But has it? What's taking over now? I want you to think about a new possibility. There's new stuff out there that we should be embracing and using email and Outlook less. Getting rid of all that inbox overwhelm or email overwhelm, right? So what I'm referring to here is rather than emailing all the time, if you are already onto the cloud, and that could be using the Microsoft 365 application where you're using SharePoint and OneNote and OneDrive and Teams, if those things are part of your organization's technology, then you definitely need to be looking at email as a source of communication less. Was that a good sentence? You definitely need to be looking at your method of communicating with others via email as something that's kind of going by the wayside. That's old technology. Let's use this new technology and let's see the advantages and why that can help us. So I'm going to start with how email, when you're receiving email, what the process is, right? So when you get an email, how can we divide up these emails that you're receiving? I have three ways that I'd like to divide them up. So I'm going to talk to you about the emails that you get that are actionable, the emails that you get that are just for your reference, and the emails that you get that are really not important to you based on your job description or what you do. So the next layer of this really is kind of giving you an idea of where this email should go. And by the way, when I say where it should go, I'm meaning that your email should not be staying in your inbox. It should not be staying in a folder, an email folder. I mean, you can certainly say there's some exceptions to this rule, but in terms of these three areas, let's look for new solutions, okay? So if it's actionable, if there's something that you have to get done, it's a task, a to-do, somebody you have to email back, or they've sent you an actual task that needs to get done, and it's date-oriented, or maybe it's about something that's coming up, an event, or something that has a date on it, then that information belongs either in your task area, and your task area, there's many places for that, but let's say tasks in Outlook, or maybe it's tasks in Teams. Or that information belongs in your calendar. And in your calendar, because it has a date to it, so you want to have it in your calendar based on that date that event is happening, or it's in your calendar because you want to block off time to get it done. Okay, so that's the actionable part. So those are the emails that I have to do something with, even if it's just a reply to that person, that's where they go. Now let's look at the emails that you get that are for reference. You received it because somebody wants you to have this piece of information. Where does that information belong? Well, it can go in a notebook, or it can go to some permanent storage. So I'm going to get into this in a little bit of detail in a few minutes here. Now, the third area is if it's not important. This is a bit of a tough one because you see what's underneath that. So if you receive email that's not important to you based on your job description, why are you keeping it? That stuff you should be deleting. And if you have any questions about this, like, oh, I don't like to delete anything, Connie. If I get it from, you know, my boss or my colleagues, I just keep it because, you know, it came from them. So then that's where you need to look at, well, look at all the information you're keeping. How many emails are you holding on to that are not about what you do, that are taking away from the value of your work in terms of trying to find your information amongst those pieces of information? Right? So how do you prioritize your email? How do you organize them? How do you not get overwhelmed by them if you're keeping all this extra stuff? Keep what belongs to you, keep what serves you and helps you do the best job you can do or have the best information that you can have for what you need to do next. And if there's questions about, well, should I keep this or should I not? Then that's where you maybe need to go back to your colleagues or your boss and ask them. If you're that person that everybody comes to and says, well, I'm just going to send it to Connie, or I'm going to ask Connie if she has it because she keeps everything, then guess what? You have a new hat on your head, a new job title that you didn't even know of, and that's because you're the new file clerk in the office, or you're maybe not, that's not new, that's that, everybody knows it. If anybody has the email, it's that person, right? You don't want to be that person. That's a new task that you have to add to your list. Who wants to go there? So let's not keep stuff that's not important to us based on our job description. Now, when we get back to, I'm going to go into detail about these three things. So if we need to action something with a date, then what we're saying is it can go into our tasks, it can go into our calendar. And you know how to do this within Outlook is that you can simply drag and drop that email into tasks, drag and drop that email into the calendar, and then it'll pop up allowing you to put a date in and all the other particulars that you need to put in. Or you could be putting it into your planner or your to-do within Microsoft 365 as well to get that stuff actioned, right? Flagging, I'm not talking about here. And, you know, I'm not saying that you can't flag stuff. I just see people abusing the flag system. They flag everything and they don't unflag anything. And so when it comes down to which thing do I need to do next? Well, there's all these flags everywhere and it's hard to prioritize a bunch of flags. So whereas if I see on my task list, these are my tasks for today, or these are the ones that are high priority versus normal, it's easier for me to decide what to do next. Okay. Now let's talk about referencing. So if I have stuff that I need to reference, somebody's giving me something, some piece of information, as I mentioned in the last slide here, it can go in a notebook or it can go into permanent storage of some kind, or maybe that reference material I can actually find somewhere else. So I'll come back to that. So let's go to the notebook. So the notebook I'm talking about here is through Microsoft 365, you have OneNote. So if you're getting a lot of emails about the meetings that you attend or about the project you're a part of or about, you know, an important part of your job description, you know, you're always getting these emails that reference this part of what you do or what you're involved in, then that makes sense for that to be part of your note system, part of your OneNote. And you can actually, within Outlook, there's a button at the top of your Outlook screen in the home ribbon, actually, that says send to OneNote. So you just send that email right to OneNote in the section or the notebook that it belongs in so that it's with all the other notes you have about that topic. Why do I want to go to my notes and go to my files and then go to my emails and have all these places to look for this topic, about the meetings or about that project? Keep it in one place. Okay, so OneNote could be that place. Now, storage, in terms of reference material that I need to store, maybe I store that on OneDrive or on SharePoint or within Teams. So now I'm just focusing on cloud storage here. You might have other places that you store stuff, and I'm talking about files that you're storing. So if it's just meant for me, so I want to keep this piece of information, it's a file that's important to me, but nobody else really needs to reference this, then I can store it into OneDrive because OneDrive is my drive for information. If it's information that someone sent me, but the whole team could benefit from, or I want to share it with everybody, then that could go into SharePoint or it could even go into Teams. And the nice thing about Teams is Teams has an extra layer of information that's kind of available to us in that we have a place to chat or post our notes. And so we could say, here's that document on XYZ, and then attach it in our chat or within our posts to the rest of the team in the channel. And so that in itself, if you're part of a team, this is where I'm telling my team students, you know, you have to let go of those old habits for you to use this new technology to its fullest potential. You have to stop emailing your colleagues and your teammates if you are on a team together. If you're on a team together, you have to build up the processes, the practices that make sense for your team to share information, and stop emailing, because that's when, if you keep using old habits or old systems, it's hard to adopt and utilize a new system. Okay, so let's go to the find it elsewhere piece here. So someone sent you a piece of information that you think, I want to keep that because I can reference it later. But if you could find that piece of information somewhere else, then I'm simply saying delete it. Now that's really harsh, Connie. That's what I get as a response sometimes, is like, I don't want to delete it. I don't really delete anything. It's like, well, okay, think about it this way. So I sent you some instructions on how to turn your notifications off on Teams or on your iPhone. And you're like, okay, thanks, Connie. We were talking about that at lunch, and now you've emailed me those instructions. Okay, great. Now you know how to turn your notifications off. So now maybe you follow those instructions and you do it. Or if you're not going to do it today, then you action it. You can put it in your tasks. But once you've gotten that instruction and you've done it, you've dealt with it, then why would you keep that? Are you going to use it again? Well, you might say, well, somebody else might want it, or I might, you know, need to look at it again for some other reason or for some other piece of technology or whatever the situation is. But the thing is, if it's instructions that you can get somewhere else, like you can Google it, for instance, then why keep it? So because by the time you need it again, it could be a month or 6 months or a year from now. How are you going to find it? It's going to be hard to find. I know you can say, oh, I search everything, Connie. Yeah, but searching brings up how many results for you? You're searching the word notification. Do you get one email popping up as a result, or are you getting 400? You know, I don't know. So the other thing about finding somewhere else is because that piece of information that you receive, maybe it's timely. And so if it's about technology, by the way, you shouldn't be keeping it if you've already applied those instructions, because you know, 6 months from now, a year from now, the instructions could be different. So you want to Google it or get an up-to-date class or course on it, you know, so that you can have the most up-to-date instructions. You don't want to keep that old piece of information. So find it somewhere else. Don't keep it. Delete it. So this last piece we're going to talk about a little bit further, and that's the delete piece. And I have let it go at the top there, because I want you to think of that, you know, that wonderful song maybe in your head, the Let It Go song. I'm not going to sing for you, don't worry, but I'm thinking of the song right now in my head. And the reasons you delete stuff or let it go is because it's not important to you based on your job description. It's no old news. It's already happened. That event or conference or that piece of information is old. Or you can find it somewhere else. So just delete it. And when I say delete, by the way, I mean delete it forever and ever, never to be seen again. I don't want you to go, oh, I delete stuff. Okay, so if I looked at your deleted items, would it be empty? Because that should be emptied out at the end of every day if you're truly deleting stuff. Like, do you go to your garbage bin at the end of every day, or, you know, once a week and pull papers out of it? Hopefully not. You know, when you throw a piece of paper away, you're throwing it away for good, right? You're not going to go back to it later on. So why would you do that with email? Stop it. Stop holding on to too much stuff. That's causing you too much extra stress, too much overwhelm, too much information that is hard to sift through. So that's what makes your job a little bit harder in terms of dealing with email. Email overwhelm or drowning in email. Those are kind of words I hear a lot from my clients. So let's open ourselves up to the possibilities of what we can do. Emailing, yes, it's certainly here for a while, but it is technology that is being replaced by better technology, and that's through the use of using your Teams, your SharePoint, your OneNote, your OneDrive better. So if you want to use these new products better, you need to let go of these old products that aren't serving you as well. All right, so try that out. Hopefully that works for you, and yeah, let me know. Bye-bye.